The health system has been traditionally very, very good at incorporating the latest technologies when it comes to diagnosis and treatment. We have been terrible, however, at adopting information and communication technologies. Despite the importance that communication plays in successful healthcare. And one clear example is the telephone. The telephone was invented, in fact, according to many people in Canada, over 100 years ago. And despite the fact that it is available to practically everybody in this country, we don't consider it as a central piece of what it means to provide health services. Many healthcare institutions, hospitals in particular, ban mobile phones, for example. Most physicians would feel very worried about giving their personal numbers to patients. And many members of the public don't even think about the role that the telephone could play to improve the quality of services that they get. The biggest challenge we have is that we are lagging badly. So we haven't figured out the telephone 100 years later. We are still thinking about email, by the way. For us, email is not obsolete. Email is a very big concern. When for the generation that is following us, it's irrelevant. So by the time we figure out email, it'll be too late. Now we have social media, and we have two different pockets, one on the information side and the other on the communication side. In terms of information, we have unprecedented opportunities to save a huge amount of resources by joining forces. And Wikipedia is a clear example of that. Anybody, anywhere, with no programming skills could contribute knowledge to a common pool. So that challenges us in very serious ways, because it questions the need to have websites created by independent groups to provide pretty much the same information. How many times do we need to define palliative care, for example? How many times do we need to describe the tools that we use to measure symptoms? How many times do we need to describe the side effects of the medication that we use? When? How many sites do we have that provide that information? At least 10 million. And we complain about the lack of resources. But each institution feels the responsibility to guarantee the quality of the information that is available on the site. So we find ourselves struggling to get resources, not only to create these places, but to maintain them. And at the end of the day, the whole is less than the sum of the parts. So imagine a world in which we all agreed to have a very small number of sites, and that we, regardless of who we are or where we are, had the opportunity to contribute to the optimal quality of that information. And Wikipedia could be a clear example. Why couldn't we adopt the sites, the articles on Wikipedia that relate to palliative care? I call it the CRAP. That is the acronym I use for academic and didactic purposes with my students and with colleagues and patient groups. The C stands for control. We are terrified of losing control. If I give you my telephone number and you're a patient, you might use it. And you may decide when to use it. And it may happen, you see, at a time when I cannot be in control. Now, what I do is I give you an appointment to see me. The R is our fear to reduce our quality of life. Because we don't think about using the phone as part of our normal workday, we immediately think, I'm going to have to answer calls in addition to my normal work. So this will impinge, this will interfere with my personal life and will reduce my own, you see, quality of life. So I reject it. A has to do with accountability. Because now I will be saying things that could be recorded, for example. Yeah, and in fact, most interactions through mobile phones can be kept in archives. Yeah. And a judge may ask for that information to be available later on. Yeah. And the P is probably the biggest single problem, It has to do with protection, financial and legal. But if you don't pay me, I won't use it. And that has been one of the biggest limitations for the use of information communications technologies in healthcare. We don't have codes that allow health professionals to be compensated financially for interactions that are different from the face-to-face consultation. And if you add to the telephone email, or the use of social media, like Facebook, what happens if a patient contacts me and asks me to be his or her friend on Facebook, and an increasing number of people do that? How would I balance the time I would spend interacting with them on the internet with the time I'm expected to be physically present at the clinic? And who's to judge? We don't have evidence that would support, you see, the assessment of how cost-effective these alternative ways of interacting with people are. There is evidence that shows that groups of 500 to 600 people with no health professional background, but who have an interest in a topic, and this was shown with breast cancer survivors, 500 to 600 people, are able to guarantee the accuracy of more than 99% of the information on a discussion list, and that the 1% remaining that is incorrect can be fixed in its majority within 10 hours by the same members of the community. So those days when, oh, it's incorrect, what are we going to do about it, are gone. And if we don't understand that, we're stuck in the 20th century, and we're going to become irrelevant. So we either understand that or get prepared to be relegated to a secondary or tertiary level of relevance for people. My kids are not going to respect you if you think I'm the authority. They want to participate in the process of management of information. Most of my practice is virtual. I have been interacting with patients by email for close to 20 years. I was probably one of the first, if not the first, physician on Facebook. I'm part of about 20 different social networks where patients, family members, and health professionals interact. Most of my patients can reach me online. And together, we are trying to find out when face-to-face interaction needs to be protected at all costs, not the other way around, which is how we are operating in most cases. We use face-to-face interaction as the default. And now we are thinking about how can technologies help us complement the face-to-face. And we have killed the relationship because most of the time we spend with each other in physical presence is used for things that are not, you see, essential to happen when we are together in the same room. So we have contaminated the relationship. So imagine the opportunities that could be created by thinking the other way around. It says, I will make sure that we will meet in person, when meeting in person will give us the best opportunity to answer questions, to deal with issues, to solve problems, okay? And then the rest we will do using other means. It's fascinating to see how we, baby boomers, are the members of the generation that has experienced most clearly the steep curve of technological development. For my grandparents, for example, the telephone was a big thing. So you had an operator first, and you had to call Lola or Mary, and you knew Mary, and she would connect people. Then we had dial-up with this circular thing. Then we had buttons. For us, it's very different. Technologies come and go very quickly. Email was a big thing for us. Nothing for my kids. For them, it's all technology. We have Twitter. Big thing for baby boomers. Probably not so much for younger generations. They can do that with Facebook and many other things. And Facebook, I find particularly interesting because of the speed with which it is developing and how much it is grabbing the imagination and the interest of younger members of society. So the challenge, however, is that anybody can set up a group to talk about something. And in breast cancer alone, we have over 600 of those groups. 45% of which, at least at this point, are devoted to fundraising, and 7% of which are dedicated to supportive care. And we are very interested in that 7%, because we are identifying some interesting patterns there. People seem to be using these groups to seek information about how to handle side effects or how to manage pain. And somehow this is challenging our own role, because people are talking to their own peers. They said, I have breast cancer and I had radiotherapy, or I'm taking this chemotherapy. I'm seeking somebody who has gone through the same experience to see if he or she would have some tips on how to manage what I'm feeling. And what we are sensing is that people are trusting more the report from their peers than from health professionals, who they deem as not really having gone through it. I haven't had breast cancer, and I could share with patients what I find in the literature or what I have learned from interacting with other patients. But what these social media are allowing people to do is go straight to sources very similar, okay, to theirs, and to try to compare notes. And this is also happening within specialized social networks, like Patients Like Me. In fact, the name of Patients Like Me comes from the intention of these brothers who were motivated by the disease of one of their siblings to try to bring as many people with similar problems as possible so they could learn from each other in ways that would be impossible to learn from the literature or from health professions. So I have had the opportunity and the privilege to be part of those conversations. And there is an increasing number of health professionals who can see the value of going where people are, not expecting them to come to us, which is a traditional approach, and see if together, you see, we can gain insights that would be impossible to gather in any other ways. Okay? Because this is real-time decision-making. See, patients are designing studies by themselves on the internet now. So they have a hypothesis, for example. They say, would this particular medication improve that symptom? And they can design the study within those large numbers of people and then gather information from individuals who have experienced the same type of symptom with similar demographic characteristics and then do statistical analysis as to whether, in fact, that particular medication is valuable or not. And if it is in doubt, still at that point, they can persuade academics, researchers, to design the studies that would try to provide, you see, answers that would be much more compelling. So we are seeing something really wonderful happening here. First of all, we were not trained on how to use this. I wasn't prepared for the internet, for the web, for social media, for Wikipedia, and all those things. So this is foreign. And we tend to be control freaks. I'm a control freak. And these tools are by definition uncontrollable. I have a profile on Wikipedia and I cannot touch it. It has been edited by hundreds of people that I don't know. There are over 300,000 hits when I put my name on Google and I don't have a clue who is saying anything about me. So we cannot control that. And when you're a control freak, you tend to reject things that you cannot control, by definition. So that's the first threat to us. I control the time of my clinic. I control who comes, when, and mostly what I do there. I control the information that I gather within my institutional domain. I cannot control what is discussed on Facebook. So control is a big, big issue. Another one is that we don't have mechanisms to incorporate these technologies in our daily practices. We are very busy doing more of the same. In addition to that, these technologies are challenging our notions of catchment areas. And one of the single most important difficult decisions I had to make was when I had a message from the first patient on Facebook asking me to be her friend.
What did you do?
I had to think long and hard. And I think that was a way for life to to get back at me because I had done the same thing with my daughters. So I created a Facebook account when I saw them so excited about Facebook many years ago. It was right at the beginning of Facebook, okay, when they opened it up. And I sent them a message just to tease them. I sent them a message, would you like to be my friend, to my two teenage daughters. And one was a preteen at the time. And I just waited, enjoying the wait. Would they accept me or not? And we would have conversations and they would not even mention Facebook and my invitation. And then a few days later, they accepted me. And then we had a conversation about that, about their dilemma as to whether they should have dad as part of their networks or not. Well, a few weeks later, I was the recipient of a message like that. And this was the spouse of a patient. And she said, would you like to be my friend? And at the end, I accepted. Imagine the implications of saying no. It's easy for us to say, it's safer to say no, but think about the implications of saying no. When I became a health professional, I promised to be a source of support to people. Control, I accepted that I don't have. And that was a very difficult conclusion to reach. But I just need to look around. I have control of a very minimum intensity within my little turf, within my little institution. And even then, if you look a little deeper than you would find that you cannot control many things. So control is gone. So once I reached that conclusion, I felt a bit liberated. Reduction of quality of life. Well, there is an etiquette. And not surprisingly, people understand that. People would not send a message motivated by a trivial thing. So if they contact you, they do it because it's important to them. And I have not been bombarded by silly messages. And we're talking about years of interactions with people. And by the way, I can be found anywhere. You just put my name on the web and you can find my email address. You can find me on Facebook. You can find me anywhere because we really cannot hide. So they are very respectful. Okay? And I can switch this thing off. And in my email messages, there is an automatic response that says that this is not for emergencies and that I don't think it's appropriate to use email for activities that require face-to-face interactions, mostly for diagnostic purposes and all that. So they know that it's a good tool for accessing information, okay? And to get a bit of relief when they are distressed about something that they cannot figure out. In terms of accountability, I'm accountable anyway. And I think I would be in deeper trouble if I said no. So I prefer to be available and to be open because I pay attention to the evidence in terms of litigation. Most of the legal problems for health professionals come from lack of access and lack of communication. So I hyper-communicate. So people feel that I'm more available than most of my peers. And that may be one of the important factors that have prevented lawsuits. I'm available. Okay? And the protection, well, there are some guidelines for electronic communication that have been developed for years and that we have ignored. So I follow them and very carefully. And if the communication is getting very sensitive with the patient, I make sure that he or she or the family know that there are limits and that we need to be very careful. And people are very sensible. I mean, you see, one of the things that fascinate me in this field is that somehow we have a double set of standards. We don't question, would people look both sides of the street, okay, before crossing it? Of course. You understand? When it comes down to these people, it's their health, and they tend to be pretty smart as to how they use the resources available to them. So I have not been abused. I have been respected very much, and all I can do is the same for them. I think the challenges we are facing in terms of the use of information and communications technologies are only going to get bigger if we keep denying them. So the first step we need to take is to open our eyes and say, this is happening, I cannot control this, and I need to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. So we need to start working with individuals and organizations who get it, or that get it. And they are not few. So we are creating a global network of people that are very interested in tackling some of the challenges together, because nobody has the critical mass to do it in isolation anywhere. But together, we might be able to do it. But this is tough, because things are moving very quickly. So instead of doing it in a health professional versus the community fashion, what we are trying to do is work with the public, especially young people, to guide us into the future. And we call that reverse mentorship. So we are working with young members of society as our mentors. And together we are trying to figure out how we can complement what we have. You see, these young, amazing people have passion, technological savvy, impatience. They don't want to wait for years for these, some of these things to happen. For them, everything is possible. What we offer in that partnership is experience. We know how to design projects. We know how to deal with politics. We know how to raise money. We know how to design, you see, the methodologies that would allow us to answer the questions. And together, we hope, but hope is always a tricky thing. Remember, for the Greeks, hope was the last devil in Pandora's box. So we hope that together we'll be able to come up with solutions that would meet our needs and expectations.